how's that?
Yeah.
All right. It's been a power-packed weekend, because I was at the women's conference and spoke on Friday, and then had gone over there on Thursday. Had a little reprieve yesterday to unpack and pack, and like she was saying, we leave at 5 o'clock in the morning to take a team down to Haiti to set up a bread making operation, and I'll probably tell you a little bit more about that in just a few minutes. But I just want to pray, because I know we've already prayed, but I got to stop a minute and breathe. This is the air I breathe.
Yes.
He is our daily bread.
Yes.
And we're lost without him. And man does not live by bread alone. That is for sure. But by every word that goes forth out of the mouth of God. I have a personal conviction of wearing a head covering whenever I speak or teach publicly in church. And it doesn't have anything to do with my background or how I was raised or a cult or anything like that. Years ago, when I was a very young, married woman, I just saw that verse in Corinthians where it says that a woman should have a sign of authority on her head whenever she prays or prophesies. So I just do that because God told me to do that. So I'm just going to be obedient to him. Sometimes I'm like, Lord, do I really have to do this? They're going to think I'm crazy, but I'm just going to be obedient, and then we're going to get going. Lord, I just thank you, and I do submit myself to your authority tonight, to the authority represented here in this church, to my husband, and to the heavenly host of angels. There's a banner over me that says I am yours, and I just praise God that you called me here to be this mouthpiece for you and for your word and all the things that you've taught me. And I thank you for this church that's so open to hearing your word and to hearing a fresh word for today. And I just pray for every family that is represented here that tonight's message would bring hope and encouragement and wisdom and direction, and that you would bless us. And you say that every place where you have put your name, that we build a memorial and an altar to you, you will hear our prayers and you will bless us. So I just thank you in Jesus' name tonight. And God, I pray that you would help clear my mind. Sometimes I'm thinking about tomorrow, and I just want to be in this moment here tonight and hear and be sensitive to your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Just like I started last week when I spoke Friday, it's really hard. I get really nervous every time I speak, even though I've been sharing this message for 25 years, because my full message, and you may laugh, you may go, how in this world could this woman talk about bread for 4.5, even 5 hours if you really get me going?
Wow.
And so when people, give me, an hour or 2.5 hours or 45 minutes, sometimes I'm like, oh dear, what do I leave out? Where do I start? How do I do this? So that's what gets me all nervous, is what is the message for you here tonight? And I told them the story about several years ago. And in fact, I was telling Sharon Becker, we were talking right before I went on. I said, I'm nervous. And she goes, why are you nervous? You know this. And I said the same thing. I said, because, I never know what time frame I'm going to have and what I should say. And I said, I've had as little as 5 minutes. And she said, oh my goodness, how could you do this in 5 minutes? I said, yes, not easy doing it in 5 minutes. And I tell this story because several years ago, I was invited to speak at an event, a very prestigious event in downtown Atlanta, and I was given 5 minutes. 5 minutes to introduce myself. My children have a joke and said, my mom can't even say her name in 5 minutes. I always tell the story on myself about, our business is, it started as a business, as a ministry, as I don't know what, all rolled in one, and God turned it into this and that and this and that, and we do all kinds of things. So a lot of times when people ask me what we do, the Bread Beckers in Woodstock, Georgia, 3 hours later, I'm still telling them. And I have a lady that was trying to help us and help promote our business. She kept saying, Sue, you got to get this down with, 2 sentences. Well, I can't. But the Lord helped me one day, because with that event that I only had 5 minutes to tell about myself, I had to pray. After struggling for weeks leading up to the event, because it was a very prestigious event, it was a real honor that I had been invited to be there as one of the 3 businesses, local businesses in Atlanta, that this famous person, if I told you who it was, you would definitely know the family, was showcasing and wanted to introduce these businesses to the public that was coming to actually hear a celebrity that was the speaker for the day. So the lady that had gotten me invited, she said, you cannot run over. I'm notorious for running over. And that's what I get so nervous about, because I want to honor people's time limits and, you know, the agenda and the schedule. And so I'm always like, oh God, I can't run over, I can't run over. She said, you cannot run over. 5 minutes is what you have, Sue. And that will be very much frowned upon, because the celebrity is who everybody's here to see, not you. So I was like, okay, I can do this, I can do this. Well, every time I'd sit down and get my little 5 minute talk, it would turn into 6 pages, and I'm like, okay, I'm leaving this out. So finally, the day before the event came, and I was really struggling. I was so nervous over 5 minutes, I mean, really. And this friend of mine called me, my prayer partner, and she said, how's it going? I said, I can't do this. I get a 6-page paper every time I try to write my little 5-minute talk. And she said, Sue, pray about it. She goes, pray and ask God to give you one word, what your message is about, what your business is about. And let that be your focus, and he'll line everything else up. I thought, what a novel idea. I had never thought of that before. So I was like, okay, I'm going to do this thing. So I prayed and I asked God to give me one word. And I often laugh and tease and say, God knows me only too well, that he knows I'm a talker and that he can't confine me to just one word, because he gave me 2 words that day. and the 2 words that God gave me just spoke right into my spirit when I said, God, what is the message? What is it really about? What's the point you want me to make? And what is it that I really do in the message, and Brad and I in our business? And the 2 words that God gave me that day were hope and encouragement. And all I can tell you is, in about 10 or 15 minutes, I had written my little 5-minute introduction. Because what the message is, and what God showed me, was that though we live in the wealthiest nation in the world, we're one of the sickest nations in the world. Chronic illness and disease just seems to plague us. I praise God for trauma care. We kind of got that covered. But in the realm of sickness and disease, we are a sick people. And unfortunately, God's people, the church, looks no different in the physical realm. And that's a sad thing. And every one of you here has probably a friend or a loved one, or you yourself are struggling with some type of physical infirmity. Maybe it's acid reflux. Maybe it's diabetes. Maybe it's heart disease, even that big. But maybe it's just sinus congestion. Maybe it's just a little overweight. Maybe it's you just really don't just feel good half the time. Low energy, depression, anxiety. Then their young mothers have children with snotty noses, sore throats, constantly sick. And yeah, we're going to be sick from time to time, but it's the constant living this way, never feeling great. How many of y'all know someone like that? Yeah, go ahead. If it's not you, you know someone. And God just showed me that it didn't have to be this way. And I stand here tonight to tell you, I'm on the same page with you in some respects. I'm a wife. Brad came with me tonight. We've been married for 40 plus years. We celebrated in September our 40th anniversary. I have 9 children, so I'm a mother. I understand. I have 7 biological children, ranging in the age from 35 to my baby will be 20 in just a few weeks, a couple of weeks. What's today? The 20th. 10 days, actually. So she'll be 20. And then we adopted 2 teenage boys from the country of Latvia. So I have 9 children. I'm about to marry my youngest, my last girl, and we have 2 boys left to be married. I have my 10th grandchild that unfortunately is going to be born while I'm in Haiti. But I will come back to see him. I'm excited. So number 10. So I'm a wife, I'm a mother, I'm a grandmother. And I understand where you're living, because I was there. We had snotty noses, ear infections. I was constipated. And I hate saying this in church, but I was. And we're going to really talk about it. And I feel real funny when I'm up in the pulpit. It's not so bad when I'm down there, you know, or at my store. But I understand, and I struggled with the same things. But 25 years ago, God introduced me to a way of life that radically changed my life. As I do have credentials, but I think what qualifies me more than anything to speak to you is I'm a wife, and I'm a mother, and I'm a grandmother, and I've lived, and I walk the life, okay?
Amen.
And I'm a food science major. I graduated from the University of Georgia, and I also received my certification to be a nutrition counselor from Trinity School of Natural Health not too many years ago, and I'm currently enrolled in the naturopathy program there. So when I was introduced, when I graduated from the University of Georgia in the school with a degree in food science, food science is not a nutrition degree. Food science is not a home ec degree. Food science is a food processing degree. It's everything that they do to your food to, in some respects, make it safe, prevent food poisoning, or even make your food, fermentation, and like yogurt and kefir and cheeses and wine and things like that. And that was kind of more my field, was food microbiology. But in my studies, I kind of came at food processing was a great thing that they did to your food to make it sit on the shelf forever and ever and ever. But the interesting thing was I went to the University of Georgia as a pre-med student. Absolutely loved the physical body. I realized right away I didn't want to be in college that long. All I ever wanted to be was a wife and mother. So I have achieved that. So, but I continued after graduating, even though I worked for Kraft Foods as a microbiologist until I had children. But I was passionate about the body, and I studied the body, and I thought, if something's not working in this body, then it's because it's not getting the nutrient that it needs. And so I would always come at sickness and disease kind of from that realm. So I continued, even after graduating from college in the 70s, to study and study and study and study. Why I never made the connection that I learned 25 years ago, I do not know. But I learned about the whole concept of milling my own grain, making my own flour to make my own bread and bread products. And in this information that I read, the history of white flour was presented, and then a brief discussion of the common diseases that plagued this nation, and it showed how it was directly related to our consumption of processed flour and bread in particular. This made absolute scientific sense to me. The bells went off. You know, it was one of those God moments. It was like, yes, this is real. And you're going to see as I go on tonight, even though I'm a little weary, I didn't get my nap today because I had to finish packing for Haiti. But you're going to see I'm pretty passionate, and I'm an all or nothing kind of person. And when I read this and saw these pieces of the puzzle and went, this is true, this is real, I went, I am doing this. And I decided I was going to mill my own flour and make my own bread for my young family. At the time, I had 5 children. I homeschooled the children, and so we were home, and I just went, we're doing this. I'm going to, and it was funny because reading over the years back in the 70s and 80s, you know, it all talked about using whole wheat flour. So I'd buy the whole wheat flour from the store. Any of y'all ever bought whole wheat flour from the store? It's gross, just so you know. Yeah. It's very dry and it's very gritty, and you have to add white flour to it to make anything taste nice. So when I read this about the mill, I was like, I don't care. We're doing this. I was assuming my freshly milled flour was going to be like that flour in the store. And I went, I don't care. We're doing this. If we have to choke this bread down, we're eating it. And white flour is not coming back in our house. So I bought the grain mill. Brad actually gave me a grain mill for my birthday. Guys, this is a great kitchen piece of equipment that you can get your wife for your birthday. She'll love it. Or Mother's Day. It's coming up. Anyway. So the mill came into our home, and I began to make all of our own bread for my family. Now, this was the only change in our diet I made at the time. The only change. Now, I preface that. I'm Southern. My mom taught me how to cook. Mealtime, I was a from-scratch kind of person, so there were no box mixes and that kind of stuff and store-bought, you know, pies and cakes. I made everything from scratch, and mealtime was typically real food, which is the premise of what I teach. Just eat real food. Shop the perimeter in the grocery store. There's only one problem. You can't get real bread in the grocery store. So we were already eating real meat, real vegetables, and I made everything homemade, and mealtime was sit down and have food. And so the bread, though, was our missing link. I started making this freshly milled flour and making our bread to put with the food that we were already eating. All I can tell you is I have tried a lot of healthy eating things over the years, reading all that I read and doing the things that I did. And this was the most noticeable, most immediate, brought, this one change brought the most noticeable, most immediate health benefits to my family than of anything I have ever tried. And I tell people often, I tried so many things over the years. Do y'all remember the brewer's yeast drink that you made the night before because it was supposed to help it taste better? Well, I don't know what it would have tasted like the day you made it if it tasted better the next day because it was disgusting. But I did it. I can choke anything down. I did green things that my kids say, that looks like goose poop. We're not doing that. But anyway, so I did the bread. And guess what? This bread tasted delicious. We didn't have to choke it down. My kids loved it. They would eat it. I didn't have to coerce them. I didn't have to say, even though it looks green, like it didn't. It looked like a muffin and a pancake and bread. And they couldn't wait for it to come out of the oven. And the health of our family changed drastically, drastically. And I got so excited because nothing that I had ever tried had, number one, brought that immediate benefits. And how many things, this is where I was going with the brewer's yeast thing, how many things that you have tried to do health-wise, maybe lose weight or change the health of your family, that you are still excited about even today? It's only March. How many of y'all made New Year's resolutions, you know, when you started trying things and you're not even doing those and it's only March? I am still doing this 25 years later, and I'm still maybe even more excited today than I was 25 years ago when I started. Number one for me, health benefit that I saw, first day, 24 hours, the meal came in our home, I milled flour, I made bread, I ate the bread, the next morning, woo, I woke up and I was no longer constipated. We're going to talk about it, but and I know y'all wanted to know that. You're really like, okay, we just didn't need to know that. But you did need to know that. No, we're the most constipated nation in the world, just in case you want to know that. I don't know how they found that out. No one called me and asked me any information about that. But we are. I'm thinking maybe they based it on laxative sales, maybe, because I've never gotten, you know, all these presidential surveys. I've never gotten one about constipation, about habits, but that's what I'm thinking. Anyway, that was done. 25 years, not been a problem. I had struggled with it all my life, even as a young girl. Doesn't bother kids, they don't really care that much. And just so you know, constipation is no longer an old person's problem. It is a significant epidemic childhood problem. I talked to several women at the conference whose kids and grandkids are on stool softeners and laxatives, and they're still not going. And but something about 35 years old, we realized that it's probably not right that we go 3 and 4, maybe even 5 days without eliminating. Just so you know, that is not right. I don't care what any doctor might tell you that might be just normal for you. That is not the way God created you, and we're going to talk about that really seriously here in just a minute. Number two, I began to notice my energy levels were boosted. This is me without caffeine, without anything to help me get hyper, except the Lord. I prayed really hard because I wanted a nap all the way here. But my energy levels, and with 5 young children homeschooling, you notice that your energy levels are up. And nursing babies, I mean, when I started realizing that I wasn't slumping over and just like, I gotta have a nap, yes, I knew that was something different. Then I began to notice my sugar cravings went away. Don't let anybody tell you that eating bread will make you crave sugar. Yes, the stuff in the store I agree with, but if we eat real bread the way God intended us to eat it, it will actually give you the carbohydrates and the energy needs that your body requires, and it will curb those sugar cravings. It will stabilize your blood sugar. Real bread, real whole grains, the most important food you can be eating to get that blood sugar stabilized, a slow release of sugar and a slow release of energy. Then a huge one for me, I began to notice that my dependence on antihistamines went completely away. I lived on antihistamines. I had always had sinus congestion and just post-nasal drip. I thought it was the way God made me. But we started doing the bread and all of this went away. And I can stand here tonight and tell you, 25 years, I've not had an antihistamine or decongestant of any kind, and I lived on them prior to the bread. And my 2 youngest children are 20, soon to be 20 and 23. They were my 2 children that were conceived and born after we started doing the bread. And they have never, never had an antihistamine or a decongestant, not one single day in their life. That is huge. I don't know if you pay attention to what's going on around you, but that is huge. One of my children's warts went away, and I won't take the time tonight to tell my full wart story, but it is pretty amazing. I'll try to give a little condensed version because this is where a lot of people, I lose them. They're like, you know, all that other stuff sounds so scientific, and I understand that, but the wart stuff sounds really, really hokey. You know, kind of like eat this bread, turn around three times, and blow some smoke, throw some over your shoulder, and your warts will all fall off. It is not that at all. Warts are a manifestation of a viral infection. And if your immune system is so weakened that it cannot fight a virus that's causing those warts, then you will keep those warts and they will spread and they are contagious. You can pass them on to someone else. And when my oldest daughter was just 3 years old, she started getting warts, took her to the doctor, and he confirmed warts are a manifestation of a viral infection. They'll run their course, they'll go away, no problem. So we went home with the warts thinking, okay, they'll be gone in a week or so, just like your cold virus or some of these other virus, stomach virus, you know, who keeps those for 4 or 5 years? Well, that's what your children or you are keeping if you have warts that have been there for 3 and 4 and 5 years. Don't think about that. Do you think they're just an unsightly thing on your hands? No, you have a virus that's contagious. Well, 3 years go by and the warts have spread like they do on her elbow or knee. She had a really big one on the back of her heel. And she even brought this up just last week. We were talking and she goes, yeah, I remember every time I'd have to go to church, my shoe would rip that wart open. And that's exactly right. It was so large. We were like, okay, the rest of these aren't really causing a problem, but this one is ripping and tearing, and a six-year-old doesn't just go barefooted everywhere you go. So we went back to the doctor and they sent us to the specialist. Anybody ever been gone to the specialist? I don't know about you, but when I go to a specialist, I think I'm gonna go in with what I have and come out without it, or at least something that's going to get rid of it. So we went into the specialist and I thought he was cut it off or burn it off, or I knew from science that you could take liquid nitrogen and freeze it off. And I thought that that's what he would do, but that was not his MO, his method of operation. He sent me home with a little bottle of very expensive acid that we were supposed to drop on the warts that were all over my little six-year-old's body. And she had them on her arms, her elbows, her fingers, and then that big one on the heel. So we started dripping this acid, and it burned like crazy, her little skin, and she would scream and wail, and then I'd be washing it off. Okay, so we didn't get the acid on, but no, never fear. We were supposed to go back to the specialist in a few weeks to see if the warts were gone, which I'm not really sure why you'd go back to see if the warts were gone, because I think I could have told him that. But anyway, so we went back and to see if the warts were gone, which they weren't, and he would pick at them, even though I had told him we weren't getting the acid on there. Okay, now here's what I want you to understand for just a minute. Think about the way we treat sickness and disease in America, if you will, for just a minute. Warts. They're a manifestation of a viral infection. This little bottle of acid that he sent me home with, that we were to drip on her skin, do you know how it was going to get rid of the warts? It was going to burn the healthy skin that was keeping that wart attached to your body. So we were going to kill the live, good skin around the wart, burn it so that the wart would fall off. That is just interesting, isn't it? Did we do anything for the virus? Well, we didn't do anything for the warts because we couldn't get the acid on her body. So I'm going to make this story short in that we went back and forth and back and forth each time he sent us home with a new way to perhaps get the acid on her body. Cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching. How many of y'all have done the cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching? You still have the thing. And so after about 6 months, maybe, of going back and forth and back and forth, still had the bleeding wart, she would scream, she would cry, it was terrible. I'll never forget, we went in that day, and I was like, we gotta do something different. This is not working, and she's getting a real problem to come to the doctor, and she's screaming, hanging onto the door. She was terrified, because it hurt, because he would pick at these things. And he said, you're right, we're gonna put her to sleep. And he got his papoose because she was screaming, and he was going to tie her up. And he brought in his trusted assistant because she was flailing so much. And I don't know, I came to my senses that day and I just said, you know what, no, we're not doing this. You're not going to anesthetize her and put her to sleep and tie her up just to get rid of horse. There's got to be a better way. On the way home that day, I remembered something in my reading that I had read. And I do this a lot with Bible verses. Do y'all see it on the page, the verse? And so you get in your Bible and you go like, I know it's right here on this side of the page, but you can't remember the chapter and the verse, but you know it's right there. Well, I remember. And I saw it just as clear as day as I'm riding home in the car that day. And I said, and it said, you know, the sentence that came to my mind was, vitamin E has been known to get rid of warts. Oh, I had vitamin E at home. Because during my study, I'd also learned that vitamin E was really good, essential nutrient to help regulate a female's reproductive cycle. And y'all are like, she is getting way too personal now. We know about her constipation, and now we got to learn about this. I did not have monthly cycles prior to having children or wanting children. Didn't care again because it's just an interruption of things. But when I got married, and then we've been married a few years, kind of wanted to have children and didn't have these cycles, well, that wasn't going to happen, you know? So I started reading and learned about vitamin E. So I began to take a pretty good hefty dose of vitamin E supplements. And within a short time, I began to have cycles, and the rest is history. I began to have children. Well, I had vitamin E at home. So I was like, all right, I will start giving her vitamin E. I began to give my daughter vitamin E capsules, and in 3 weeks, the warts were completely gone. 3 weeks, vitamin E, I had it in my cabinet all along. Well, her brother, all along this time, had gotten the virus from her, and he had started getting warts, and so I started giving it to him too, and his were gone in just a week or so. So a few years go by, my third child, I don't know what it is about 3 years old, but he turned three, he started getting warts. And I'm like, where did this come from, you know? So I knew what to do, right? I didn't have to take him to the specialist. I had the vitamin E. So I began to give Joshua vitamin E capsules. Well, tried to give Joshua, that's the key word, because Joshua couldn't swallow the vitamin E capsules. Have any of y'all ever seen vitamin E capsules? They're a little gelatin thing. They're about this big. They're not some honking horse pill. You know, they're this little gelatin capsule that almost will just slide right down your throat. But no, Joshua, you know, and spit up. He couldn't swallow them. 3 years old. So at this point in my life, warts were not a big priority. If Joshua could have just swallowed the capsule, all would have been good. But by the time Joshua was 3 years old, when I got pregnant with Joshua, my third child, I had decided that I would accept all the children God had for me, that I would give my body to the Lord, I would trust Him. If children were a blessing, we don't control any other blessings. We don't go, oh no, Lord, I don't want that blessing. You know, and I thought, well, if children are a blessing, then I'm going to trust the Lord to give me the children that He wants me to have and to control the number of children that I have. Well, I'm here tonight to tell you, He didn't control it at all. Not the way I thought He would. I had three children in 3 years. So Joshua was three, and he had two younger siblings. He had warts, and he couldn't swallow vitamin E. But I was tired. This was before bread. I had a baby, a nursing baby, so it was like I did the Scarlett O'Hara thing, you know, I'll think about this tomorrow. And so we just moved on. 2 years go by, the warts have spread, just like I figured they would, and he had a big wart on his fingernail that was about to push his fingernail off. At this point, when Joshua was five, the milk came into our home. Grains are the richest food source of vitamin E that God has given us. Grains and beans and seeds, any food that has oil in it has vitamin E, because vitamin E protects those fats and oils and keeps them from oxidizing in your body and out of your body. But it must be freshly milled. So that milk came into our home, and I began to grind our flour and feed my family freshly ground whole grain bread and muffins and pancakes and cookies and brownies or whatever. And at some point in that first month, and all these other things I've told you happened, they all happened within 1 month of changing the bread. And some point during that month, I looked down and all of Joshua's warts were gone. No vitamin E capsules, God's perfect provision. I knew it was the bread because of what had happened before. And I often think of things that happen in our lives, and I'm like, that happened so that I would know what was happening over here. And I'll tell you something, warts are the number one testimony that we hear about the bread. And the most amazing one that I know of was I was speaking at a homeschool conference in Richmond, Virginia, and this I only had 45 minutes to speak there, and so I was hurrying, and I got to the wart story, and I started not to tell it, and I just felt the Lord say, yep, tell it. So I told it, and then I just kept hurrying, and I had about 5 minutes before I was supposed to be done, and the next speaker was coming right in and waiting at the back door, and I just came to a stopping point. I wasn't finished. I could have talked for 3 more hours, but I came to a stopping point, and this has never happened before and never happened since. I just kind of came to a stopping point, felt like the Lord said stop, and I was like, well, all right, I got 5 minutes left. Anybody want to share? 2 people shared wart testimonies. And so I packed up my books after and walked, headed back to my booth, and waiting outside my door was a mom with her young daughter, 17 years old, beautiful teenage girl, and her mom was just tears pouring down her cheeks. She said, because I don't know if any of y'all have ever been to a homeschool conference. Those of you who haven't, there's workshops going on all, you know, several million, not millions, multitudes of workshops you can choose from. And she said, I was walking down the hall to go to this other workshop, and the Lord told me to come in your room. She said, I had no idea what this was about. The next thing you know, you're talking about pooping and bread and all this stuff. And she said, then you got to the wart stuff. And she said, my daughter has over 500 warts on her. She had, when I looked, I could see that they were all in her hairline. You didn't just go, ooh, you got warts on her face. She was beautiful. But she had these little tiny, almost clear warts all in her hairline, all on her eyebrow, eyelashes. And then she pulled up her pants like she had a spot about this big that she had counted over 200 warts on this one big patch on her leg. She was humiliated. She started getting them, the mother explained. She was 12 years old. She said they had them all burned off. They all came back. Imagine that, because they didn't touch the virus. They just took away the symptoms, you know? And anyway, make a long story short, she'd been on medication. She said, my daughter's currently on ulcer medication. They say it must be stress-related. And she followed me back to the table. She tasted the bread. She looked at me, she goes, how much is a grain mill? And I said, $219, $220, whatever. And she said, you know what? I paid more than that for one prescription medication that didn't even work. And she said, I like to cook, and we can at least eat this. We like to eat. You know, none of us got to enjoy the prescription that didn't work that was $200 $300. What have I got to lose? This mom took that grain mill home and called me 2.5 weeks later. Every one of that child's warts were gone. Every one of them. And a few years ago, I was back in Richmond, Virginia speaking, and that young girl is now a mother. And she came into me, pulled her sleeves up, said, look, Mrs. Becker, still no warts. She was so ecstatic. So that is God's perfect provision of virus. And you may be thinking, well, that's just warts, you know. But heart disease, cancer, diabetes, Psalm 104, verse 16, it says, God gave man bread to strengthen and nourish the heart. But, you know, and so, and you may be thinking warts are insignificant, but remember again, it's a virus that you have for 3 and 4 and 5, 10 years that is not going away because your immune system is so weakened. And God does not want us to live that way. He wants us to be healthy and strong. Needless to say, after all these things, I became very, very excited. I began to share my bread with other people. And like I said earlier, the bread was delicious. This was healthy food my whole family would eat. Though I would do things and drink things that tasted nasty, and I would eat the salads. And this is what I see happening also in America. We're getting to be 30 and 40 years old, and mom and dad are a little overweight, had a bad physical, your blood pressure's up, your cholesterol's up, and you decide that you're going to eat real food, and you're going to change the way, or you better change the way. And so you're eating the fish and the salad and the broccoli and the meat and the chicken and all that, and you're cutting open the box for the kids to have the frozen pizza, the mac and cheese, the hot dogs, and the chicken nuggets. And this should not be that way. And that is what so excites me about the bread. I tell young mothers all the time, I said, don't worry if they eat anything else, just give them the bread. It's the most nutrient-dense food God has given us. Jesus compared himself to bread for a reason. Of the 44 nutrients absolutely needed by your body to promote life, to sustain life, and to promote good health, there's only 4 missing in wheat. And some of the other grains have those. And if you sprout those grains, they have them all. Vitamin A, so I tell people, eat some carrots, eat some sweet potatoes, eat something yellow or orange. Vitamin C, eat fruit. Most of your kids will eat fruit. Vitamin D, get them outside, get you outside, playing in the sunshine on a nice sunny day with no sunscreen. Jesus didn't have sunscreen. They were just wise. They dressed appropriately and so just get out there. And then lysine is an amino acid that's slightly low in grains, but guess what? Beans have them and nuts have them. Do you think it's any coincidence that many cultures eat rice and beans, cornbread and beans, peanut butter and jelly sandwiches? This is because those two food groups complement each other perfectly. So I became excited because the bread tasted so delicious and was healthy foods my kids would love, other kids would love. Yeah, they have likes and dislikes. But God led us to starting a business called the Bread Beckers, because one by one, as I made bread for other people, I'm not kidding you, I have wart testimonies of one loaf of bread. And one lady, she said that the wart was like a second appendage, that the doctor said the only way he could get that wart off would basically be to amputate her thumb. It was so grown in her thumb. And he said, just live with the wart. And so a customer of mine that had heard me speak had just baked bread that day. She had 3 loaves of bread sitting on the counter. And she said, here, you want to just take one of these loaves of bread? I heard this lady talk about how to get rid of warts. She said, Sue, my friend called me ecstatic. Before she finished the first loaf of bread, the wart was going away. Wow, this is God's perfect provision. So it was things like these constantly coming at me, getting a phone call one day. Hello, it's the bread. It's got to be the bread. Excuse me, who is this? My cholesterol dropped 85 points in just 1 month. I'm on my 3rd doctor, 3rd type of medication, and nothing has touched it. And all I changed was the bread. And you know what she liked? I made bread for her. She was an older woman. Her favorite thing that I made was a cinnamon roll with cream cheese icing, and she ate one after every meal. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. Is that a hard pill to swallow? And her cholesterol dropped 85 points in 1 month. I have people's lab work. They send it to me. Triglycerides dropping 93 points. Total cholesterol, 99 points. In 1 month. When I see the Cheerios ad of 8 points in 1 month, I'm like, you ain't got nothing on me. This bread, 90 points. And what other people have told me, they sent me their lab work, they say, the doctor can't believe it. In just 2 weeks, my good cholesterol, which that's a whole nother story that I don't have time to get into tonight. There's no such thing as good and bad. But anyway, what they call your good cholesterol, it's very hard to get it to come up. It had come up like 40 points in 2 weeks. And all she had changed was the bread. Now you know why Jesus compared himself to bread. And we began our business in the fall of 1992, right before the presidential election of that year. Do y'all remember 1992? Clinton and Bush. Do you remember that one? And all I can tell you was, I woke up the next morning after that election. We started our business 1 week before with the health benefits, and you know, and I do want to tell you this, because this is what I'm excited about. It just came to me sitting over there. Somebody said something, I don't know what, and it reminded me of this. Over the years, Brad was in construction, my husband Brad, and he would always tell me, you know, we need to start a business. I want our own business. He was a union carpenter, millwork carpenter. And, you know, when he worked, and it was usually, he was the trim guy. So they were at the end of the job, when the job was behind schedule. So he would work, you know, 24/7 sometimes, you know. And so money, overtime, it was coming in. And then he might go 2 or 3 weeks with no job, you know. So we were used to that. But he also said, I want to start a business that's as recession-proof and depression-proof as possible. People got to eat. And he said, it needs to be a food-related business. So we had tossed around pizza place because everybody loved my homemade pizza. And we had tossed around all these things. And I started making bread for people, and it started just growing and growing in my little home with my little one wall unit oven. I was pregnant with my sixth child and making bread for people, and they were coming. And I'll never forget, finally, one day I just like, I cannot do this. And it just came to me. And Brad drove up in the driveway in his green pickup truck, and I met him in the driveway. And I said, I think I figured our business out. I said, I don't think I'm supposed to make bread for the world. I think I'm supposed to teach the world how to make bread for themselves. And we sat down on the swing right there in our carport, and I said, I think we're supposed to start a business. I want to sell meals, and I want to teach people how to make bread. I am so excited. And maybe when you said Haiti or whatever that I was going, tomorrow when we leave to go to Haiti, here's what I'm excited about. We're not taking them bread. We have sent meals, and I actually got a picture yesterday. They have already gotten that meal out, which was supposed to be for me to get there, and they already made bread with it. But we are going down there, and when this church approached me in January and said, you've got to come. We want you to come and tell us how to set up a bread-making operation to grind this flour. We want to give these kids the most nutrient-dense food we can, and we want to do it right, God's way. So I'm so excited that now I am teaching the world how to make bread for themselves. So we're going to Haiti. And let me just tell you, I don't want to take up too much time, but I got to tell you about this. The two pastors that I met from Haiti came and heard me speak this message at a church in Port St. Lucie, January 31st. They had heard about me before, had sent me an email, and had said, can we see you after you speak at this church? And I said, yes. Interesting thing, January 8th, I wrote in my journal, I've looked back, I don't know how I got in Ecclesiastes. It wasn't in my, I was reading through the Bible year, so it wasn't where I was supposed to be reading. Looked through all my devotional books, I can't find how I got in Ecclesiastes, but somehow, January 8th or 7th, I read Ecclesiastes chapter 1, and it says, Ecclesiastes 11, verse 1, and it says, cast your bread on many waters, and you shall be rewarded. In my journal, I said, God, show me what waters you want me to cast my bread on. January 18th, I received this email from a customer of ours from this church where I was going to speak, and she goes, there's these two Haitian pastors. They really want to talk to you about getting this bread down there. And I'm thinking, okay, somehow they want me to try to get bread down there. Oh, no. So once I got there and they told me what they want to do, the two pastors together have about 50 orphanages scattered throughout Haiti. They want to start with three. The main one they want to start in has about 250 children that live in the orphanage. They eat twice a day. What they're wanting this orphanage to do is to begin to grind their own wheat and make their bread, to sell the bread to the village people to help them become self-sustaining. They've already taught them how to garden, and they've increased their income. Their income was, are you ready for this? Just hold on. $12 a year was their income. By the produce that they're now growing, they've increased their income to $12 a month. So now they're wanting to bring this bread in and start this bread operation. But the big thing is the village school, where the village kids come and go to school, is about 400 children. And they want to make this bread for the kids, because the average child that comes to this school eats every other day, only gets food every other day. Moms have been known to make dirt, mud, cookies to just have something to put in their babies' tummies to fill them up so they don't scream. So here's what they're wanting to do. They're thinking, if we're only going to give them one meal a day when they come, and they come to the school hoping to get something to eat. That's really why they're coming to school. We want it to be the most nutrient-dense food there is, and grains are it. Fruits and vegetables are wonderful, but they rot and they only do so much. Did you hear what I said? Of the 44 nutrients needed by your body, only 4 missing in grain. So that's what they're wanting to do. So I'm super pumped about going in the morning, and I am leaving, and we're just, my pastor, he's gotten on board, and he worked for a feed and seed store, so he's got a whole bag full of seeds that were going to take them, because that was, I was like, why aren't they gardening? And he emailed the pastor of where we're going, and he said, we can't get seeds. So we're taking seeds, and he's gotten some heirloom seeds so that they can save those seeds and go for the next year. I'm digressing a little bit, but I'm so excited because I told my husband, I can't make bread for the world. I want to teach the world how to make bread for themselves. And so we started, and then that day after the election, I'll never forget, and this is maybe what Rich heard me share, and I don't always share this, but I woke up very early, it was raining, it was misting, you know, it was in November, and I just felt like it was the heart of God. As I saw his people, obviously his people had to choose ways, or our nation choose ways that were diametrically opposed to God's ways. And I just felt like his heart was breaking. And I went in, we were all my kids and Brad were in this one little hotel room. I'm not sure why, but anyway, we were. So the only place I had to go to get alone and turn on the light without waking everyone up was in the bathroom. I sat on the cold bathroom floor, and I remember God spoke so very clearly to me. He said, I am raising you and Brad up through your business, the Bread Beckers, to be like Joseph, to supply my people with grain when the public needs it. Hard and difficult times are coming, and grains are storable. So I began to get very excited, and he said, you will be like Joseph. And I wrote in my journal that day that it would be a tremendous thing. Brad caught the vision. We came home that week, and my son came home with his Sunday school lesson that we had to help him answer the questions. Guess where they were? The story of Joseph. David Wilkerson, we get his newsletter, been getting it for years and years and years. That next week got one, the Joseph Company, all about that God was stirring in the hearts of his people to begin to prepare for hard and difficult times. Thought Y2K was it, because this was 92 and that was 99, that was 7 years. I thought, ooh, this is it. It wasn't. It came and went. People bought grain. But I became very, very excited. Now, Brad caught the vision right away, and like I told you, he was in construction, and during those days of overtime, he would make a good bit of money, and so we would save, and we had a savings account, and we always had a little savings account, a nest egg, to pay the bills during those times when he might be out of work for a little while. So he came home one day, and we had saved up a little bit of money, and he said, Sue, he said, I want to buy some grain. God's told me to be like Joseph, and I want to buy some grain. So I was like, okay. So he called one company, and it was out in Idaho, and he ordered 5,000 pounds of grain from there. And they said, we don't know when it'll be. We don't ship very regularly to the southeast, so when we get a whole truckload coming that way, we'll put it on. It could be weeks, months, we don't know. So we're like, okay. So we found another supplier and ordered 5,000 pounds of grain, and he told us the same thing. We're like, well, alrighty then, how do we get grain here? But nonetheless, we're like, okay, we got it ordered. Now, this can only be a God thing. One was in Montana, one was in Idaho. They don't communicate with each other, but 1 week we got a phone call and said the truck from one place would be here, and not too long later we got a phone call saying the other truck was gonna be there. Those trucks came within just a few hours of each other. On 3 hours, on the same day, two truckloads a week came and dropped one 5,000 pounds. So we had 10,000 pounds a week already, all of a sudden. 10,000, went from none to 10,000. Well, guess what we didn't have? Our savings account. My little nest egg, my little security blanket, my little thing I fall back on when Brad's out of work. Because I wrote the checks, we're excited. We were hauling that wheat, putting it up in his mother's barn, and we worked all day, and I was great. Had the vision, tremendous thing. Joseph, yes, we're going to do this. Till I went to bed that night. Brad was obviously tired than I was, because he was gone. He was out. Any of y'all have husbands that just, yes, they can sleep through it? And all of a sudden, my mind, it's clear conscience, he's saying, my mind starts going. I'm like, what in the world have we done? I was just like, oh my gosh, we're one of those preppers. We're one of those survivalists. We've got our grain. What in the world? I really did. I was thinking all this. What is this? And So I got up and I couldn't sleep. I'm just freaking out because our money was gone. And I'm like, yeah, I don't think the electric company's gonna take buckets. I've got lots of buckets of grain, you know. So I was really freaking out. And so I just kind of sat down and I tried to pray. And here's what I do. I know enough Bible that I could get myself in trouble. I could have gone to Joseph. I can find scriptures that will say what I want to hear. Are y'all like that, you know? But I don't do that. So what I try to do is if I'm really praying about something or especially distressed about something, I'll just pray about it and I try to leave it with the Lord. And then I go on with my regular Bible reading. So part of my Bible reading, you know, I told you I get these newsletters from David Wilkerson. I have been getting them for about 35 years, I think, maybe even more. And every year he sends this little calendar, this promise calendar. And I keep it in my Bible, and it's just one little part of my Bible reading. But usually, you know, I'll read my Bible, and then at some point I'll go, well, I'll see what my verse for the day is. So I open my calendar after praying and crying out to God. And it's funny, my prayers that day, I'll remember them very clearly because this is what it was. And y'all ever ask God this? I was like, God, are you sure this is what we were supposed to be doing? Why I was asking God, was he sure? But have y'all ever prayed that? And I was like, oh, and I was just so distressed. And the main thing I was distressed about, besides the money being gone, was I just wanted to make sure we weren't being deceived. You know, we weren't becoming one of those weird people, you know. So I cried out to God. And then I decided I would look at my verse of the day. And my verse of the day was Proverbs 11. And it was actually 25, verse 25. But I always read the verse in front and the verse after. And so the verse was, the generous man is a source of blessing and shall be prosperous and enriched. And he who waters will himself be watered, reaping the generosity he has sown. But verse 26, the people will curse him who holds back grain when the public needs it, but a blessing from God and man is upon the head of him who sells it. Wow. You couldn't have kept me sitting on that sofa any longer. I was so excited. When Brad woke up, I told him, I said, you're not going to believe this verse. I mean, God answered every one of my fears. First of all, I hated selling. We had started this business and people would say, how much is a bucket of wheat? And I'd go, I'm sorry, it's this much, I'm so sorry. You know, I felt so bad. But God said, people will curse him who holds back grain. Also, the whole hoarding mentality, not good. That is not from God. So many people, I think, get turned off with the survival mentality, the prepper mentality, because it's, we're digging in, gonna buy that remote farm out there, and it's guns, gold, and grain, and I'm gonna shoot you if you try to get it, yeah. Right? Yeah. But God says he will curse those who hold back grain when the public needs it.
That's good.
But a blessing from God and man is upon the head of him who sells it. Did you know that Joseph sold that grain? He ended up with all the wealth of Egypt. He sold it, even to his own people. And they had to give him their grain that they were growing to put in the storehouse. Share with you from Genesis, where Joseph, when his brothers came to him, and you all quote this verse all the time, you know, when his brothers came and they were repenting, and Joseph said to them, we quote the verse, he says, you know, do not be distressed, Joseph said, or angry with yourselves, because you sold me here, for God, it says, what you did for evil, God turned to good. And I've never seen this before. It says, for God sent me ahead of you to save life and to preserve our family. God sent me ahead of you, and he says it again, to Egypt to preserve for you a remnant on the earth and to keep you alive by great escape. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God.
Yes.
And he has made me like a father. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh and Lord of his whole household. So we quote that thing about what you intended for evil, God meant for good. But do you see what he says? God sent me ahead of you. And that is where we've got to come to with the preparedness mentality. And you don't necessarily prepare what someone else is preparing. You prepare what God has put in your heart to prepare. And I think the other thing that sometimes can turn people off is we kind of think of the doom and gloom, the world is coming to an end thing. But did you ever think about a power outage, an ice storm, a gas leak in your neighborhood, a flood? What do you think about Mississippi? What's been going on there? Those are things that we can get ready for and be ready for. And I believe God wants us to do this as a community, amen, as a church. And that is what I like about this book here. I brought some things, and I'm really diverting from what I was really going to start with. But I brought some books here. This is the Ultimate Prepper Book. This will tell you how to build a wood oven, how to milk a cow, how to make cheese, how to do whatever it is you're wanting to do on your own to become somewhat self-sufficient. But it's arts that we have lost. Our grandparents, great-grandparents, they knew how to do this. Other countries, that's why I was so shocked. I'm like, why are we having to teach Haiti to garden? I would think a very primitive society would. It's because they can't even get the natural resources. They're the poorest nation in the Western Hemisphere. 54% of the people don't work. Those that do are making $12 a year. But this book here, I would encourage you, as a church, as a community, those of you that live in a neighborhood, get this book by Dr. Paul Williams, When All Plans Fail. This is not like any prepper book you've ever read, because you're not going to learn how to build a wood stove. But you'll learn lots of other things and other ideas of water sources and things like that. Dr. Paul Williams came to our warehouse back in August and taught a class. He was an MD doctor that gave up his private practice to go do ministry, missionary work, and his was disaster relief. He went to New Orleans when Katrina came. He's gone to Ethiopia. He's been where the tsunamis hit. And he said, it is absolutely devastating. But what God did to him in those times when he was just going as a medical missionary to go help with medical needs, God opened his eyes to the needs of the people around them and what was going on. He said one of the main things is loved ones not being able to find their other loved ones when you get separated like that. And so he talks about in this book how to come up with some plans. You can't be prepared for everything, but just simple things like in your neighborhood, if there was a tornado or something like that, if you have a meeting in your neighborhood and you just say, put a simple sign in the window, I'm okay. Then when they're coming through that neighborhood, and instead of having to go to every house to find out if someone's in there and not okay, if they see the sign in the window, they can go, okay, we don't have to waste our time going through every room of that house. We can move on. How simple is that? He talks about getting your documents in order. He talks about coming up with a plan, finding out who knows CPR and who knows life-saving things, finding out who in your church or who in your neighborhood lives on some type of life support. That if power goes out, it could be a life-threatening situation. And he told a story about this man or child that was, and the family was frantic. And so the community had to come together and raise money to get a generator, you know. If you know that you already have that need, why wait? until there might could be a power outage. Yes, the generator may sit there and never be used, but you never know. So these are just practical. Get your documents in order. Get medicine, you know, up 2 or 3 months ahead. And he talks about ways to do that. Those of you that are on co-pays and insurance, sometimes they won't let you. And he said, what if you have to pay for 1 month out of pocket? You've got it. And that way, if something happens and you can't get it, you've got it. You know, come up with where are you going to go if a tornado hits your house so that your loved ones know where to look for you if they can't get a phone or whatever. So just very practical things. So I really encourage you. This is a great, great book, When All Plans Fail, and even has a workbook that gets you on a, like, I think it's a 6-week program, or it gets you on a program of one step at the time of doing these things, having church meetings, having community meetings. But I do want to spend just a few minutes, and because one thing, I don't want to go too far over there on the food preparation, but I want to talk to you just a minute about why grains are so nutritious. I probably am not going to get to my poopy talk tonight, and that may be fine because I feel funny talking about it here. But this white CD will tell you all you need to know about why your bowels need to move every day and why it's directly related to your low energy, your weakened immune system, why you're not fighting the virus, why you even have sinus congestion. But if you will, I am going to show you why grains and beans are so nutritious. And then we're going to talk about how they're and why they're storable and why they're the perfect storable food and why God told Joseph to store grain. First of all, grains are the only food that we eat that are the seed of the plant as well as the fruit of the plant. Have you ever thought about that? Fruits and vegetables, one of my 7 steps to healthy living is eat more fruits and vegetables. We all need to be reaching for the apple, the orange, the banana, the broccoli, the green beans instead of the apple-flavored fruit bar and the cocoa pebbles and whatever things that we're reaching for, the candy bar. If you need a banana or something, those things would satisfy those sweet cravings. But what happens to fruits and vegetables over time? They decay and they rot. And even some studies will show that every day they're sitting off the tree, they're even losing nutrients. Not so with your grains and your beans. And when I say bread, bread to me can be a muffin, a pancake, a piece of bread, but it can be a pot of beans and rice, a helping of grits, oatmeal, cream of wheat. You know, it can be all of these things because it came from a grain. And when I say grains, I'm also lumping beans in there with it because these are seeds. Can y'all see over there okay? All right. So here is this kernel of grain, and God created these seeds with a hard outer surface, and this, it's actually not just the surface, it's several layers thick, and this is known as the bran. This is where your fiber is. Many, many, many of your vitamins and your minerals and your nutrients are here in this bran. The germ here is where the life of the seed is. This is the sprout. Everything that plant is ever gonna be and do is there in the germ. And the everything else out here is these little packets of protein and starch, and it's known as the endosperm, better known to you and I as white flour. Now, you didn't know I was going to tell you, white flour is actually very healthy for you. It provides you with all your proteins that you need. Many, many proteins, many amino acids are here in the white flour. But for all practical purposes, all the vitamins, all the minerals, all the fatty acids, the vitamin E, all the fiber are in the bran and the germ. That's where it is. The function of the bran to the seed is to protect this life and the integrity of the seed. Left whole and intact, this seed will store forever. Think about it. If it didn't, you wouldn't have next year's crop. They used to store seeds. In fact, it's just as nutritious today as it will be next week, next month, next year, 10 years from now, 3,000-4,000 years from now. There's tombs in Egypt where they discovered that were 3,000 and 4,000 years old, and they found kernels of grain in them, and when they planted them, they grew. What does that tell you about that seed? It's alive. Amen. It's alive food. And I love fruits and vegetables. I don't want anybody to think I don't like fruits and vegetables, but I get kind of irritated with people that say, oh, you got to eat raw food. It's live food. It is not. It's dying. You can't plant a banana and grow a banana. You got to have what? The seed. The seed. Grains are alive food. Grains are alive food. They can procreate. And I tell you, I just did a little study on seeds, a devotional on seeds. Oh my goodness, and when my pastor opened his suitcase today and showed us all these bags and bags of seeds that we're taking to Haiti, did you know that those big sequoia trees that are out there, they come from one tiny seed? And we read that verse about reaping what you sow and planting a seed and, you know, the grain. And if you have faith like a kernel of mustard seed, you know. And so we think, oh, and you read it and it talks about how it becomes this big plant. And we think of that seed as becoming this big plant. That one seed grows that huge sequoia tree. And the life of that sequoia tree is like 2,000 years. And every year, you know what it produces? 400,000 seeds. So when you talk about planting a seed, you're not talking about just getting a plant. You're talking about getting a forest, not just a tree. You're talking about something that the next generation and the next generation is going to be able to have. He tells a story in this devotional I was reading about the carob plant. That it takes like 75 years to produce. Like, well, why would you plant something that you're not even probably going to enjoy for your children and your grandchildren? Because I enjoyed it, so that meant somebody back here planted it. Have you ever thought about that watermelon seed that you got to spit out? How in the world does from that seed comes a green rind, a red interior, and that seed? How can anybody say this happened? I don't know. I'm getting kind of choked up here. Just thinking about seeds and God's perfect provision. And this is what God has given us. And he said in Genesis, I give you every seed-bearing food, plant. For food. Wow, this is huge. God gave us this for food. Amen. And guess what we did to it? Because here's what's happened. When you break this kernel of grain open, like when I mill it into flour, and you expose all those nutrients to the air, guess what begins to happen? A process that you know, it's not that scientific, it's called oxidation. You might be going, I don't know anything about that. Yes, you do. You ever cut an apple open and watched it turn dark? A banana, a pear, whatever? Yeah, that's called oxidation. Same thing happens, you just can't see it to other foods. It's happening. That's what makes fruits and vegetables lose their nutrients. Every day they're stored in the refrigerator or whatever. You smell rancid oils. It's the same. It's an oxidation process. When you break this kernel of grain open and you expose those vitamins and minerals to the air, you've compromised its integrity, you've exposed all these oils and the vitamin E to the air, oxidation takes place, and from everything I've read, in the first day, you can lose about 45% of those vitamins and minerals, and those oils start going rancid immediately. In just 3 days, you can lose as much as 90%, and guess what? Vitamin E is going to be one of the first to go. Because vitamin E is known as an antioxidant. It's going to protect the other nutrients from being destroyed. The best analogy I've come up with is it's like the front line in the military. The front line is protecting all the guys behind it. That's what an antioxidant does. What's going to be the first to go? The front line. So your vitamin E is going to go pretty quickly. In fact, Dr. Wilfred Shute, world-renowned cardiologist, traveled all over the world. He was from Canada. And he said, I found the treatment for heart disease. And he was treating his patients for heart disease with, guess what? Vitamin E. That's why Psalm 104 says, God gave man bread to strengthen and nourish the heart. He was finding by giving them vitamin E that their heart would become strong. And I read a quote by him. And he wasn't talking about milling your own grain and making your own bread. He was using supplemental vitamin E. But he said, and I'm getting a little ahead of myself, when white bread came on the market, that mankind lost the most potent, he called it antithrombin, anti-clotting agent. You know what's causing all the, why we're all on blood thinners? Because we don't get the vitamin E from the bread that God designed to give it to us. Because here's what's happening. Prior to the 1900s, the bread baked in this country was done so at home. People either had the capacity to mill their own flour, or communities built up around the miller. That's where I'm going to the millers today. That's where the name came from. And have you ever thought about how, especially in Atlanta, there's so many mill roads around. We have pool mills, pools mill, rope mill, Howell mill, Sewell mill. I can't think of all the other mills. But that's because communities built up around the millers. Used to that flour was ground with two rocks, and then it changed to the oxen. When wind power and water power came on the scene, more flour could be ground than one family could eat. So that's why all of a sudden we got a market for flour. And so the miller was a very prominent man in the society. Women were like, hallelujah, I can just go to the miller and get my flour. And that was okay because he wasn't doing anything to it but grinding it and selling it to you. And people would buy just what they needed and they'd go home. Of course, they were using a lot because they were making bread for large families and farmhands and everything. But something happened in the late 1800s. Because you see, not only do these nutrients oxidize, and they were not aware of that, but they knew the flour was spoiled. They could smell it. They could taste it. Those oils went rancid. And they discovered in the late 1800s, if we sift this very nutrient-rich bran away, and we sift the oil-laden germ away, and leave only the protein and starch, this flour won't spoil at all. So it led to the invention of these huge steel rolling mills that would flatten the grain so that the bran and germ were bigger particles, run it through a sifter, the white flour would come over here, the bran and germ would go over here. The white flour was sold to the people and the bran and germ to the cattle feed market. This was a unique, wonderful discovery, they thought. These huge steel rolling mills, hallelujah, we can now produce massive volumes of this long-lasting white flour. The local millers went out of business, and the grain mills moved out west where the wheat was grown. Because now, it wasn't the wheat that had to ship across the country that would last forever, the white flour would last forever. So it didn't matter anymore. So no more local millers. Everybody was like, hallelujah, we have this wonderful flour that won't spoil. But do y'all have ever heard this verse? There's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. Because let me tell you what happened. Three diseases became epidemic. All of this happened. The steel rolling mills came on the scene late 1800s. By 1900 to about 1910, especially 19, by 1920, white bread, white flour was the food for the rich and poor alike, the masses. Everybody had said, hallelujah, no more grinding, I'm going to eat this white bread. Well, guess what happened? Three diseases became epidemic at the time. Beriberi, which is a vitamin B1 deficiency, results in nervous disorders. Pellagra is a vitamin B3 deficiency. You ready for this one? Skin eruptions, GI disturbances, mental insanity, and finally death. It's known as the disease of the four Ds. The first case of pellagra seen in Georgia, actually ever, was diagnosed in Atlanta, Georgia in 1907. There were thousands of deaths following, and just all these cases all of a sudden began to happen. Georgia was particularly plagued by pellagra, South Carolina as well, because so much of our diet was corn and wheat. And when they started fracturing the wheat, we lost those sources of B1 and B3 and all those B vitamins. And I read one article that said that it was so bad, the mental institutions in Georgia and South Carolina were literally overflowing. They did not have enough beds to house the patients. I'm talking, this was a serious crisis. Anemia was the third epidemic. Health officials all over the nation were trying to figure out what in the world is going on with this new, you know, with these diseases. Why are we seeing these? What's happening? They eventually traced the problem to the B vitamin deficient white flour that was on the market. They went to the millers. They urged them to put the bran and germ back in. They refused because why? The byproduct of the milling process was being sold to the cattle feed industry. Very lucrative market. And the white flour was being sold to me and you. This is being done across the board now with God's perfect provision. God's food that He has given us to nourish our bodies has been reduced to nothing but a raw material by the food industry. They separate it all out and sell this part to that company, this part to that industry, and this part to that industry. And we wonder why we're sick. We have altered God's design. The best book I can tell you to read on healthy eating, please go home with my two free CDs. The poopy talk is the white CD. The red CD is my rebuttal to the whole anti-grain, anti-gluten. Wheat does not make you fat. Wheat has not been genetically modified in this country. I don't care what you've read on the internet. It is not true. Please get the red CD and listen to it. There's also a card out there that's just the kind of a synopsis. I laugh and say, this CD is about 55 minutes long. It's my rebuttal to the wheat belly and anti-gluten and anti-grain propaganda. And my son-in-law condensed me to the back of an index card out there. I'm like, wow, how'd you do that? But he probably like condensed me in more ways than one. But anyway, there's a card back there that you can read. But grab one of those cards that says the truth about wheat. And get it, stick it in your purse, because I promise you, coworkers are talking about wheat being genetically modified and how wheat's making you fat, and they went off of it and they feel great. Well, it's because they went off of the store-bought stuff, okay? But this book here, Dr. Rex Russell, this is one of the best books I've ever read on healthy eating. Three basic principles. Eat what God created for food, don't alter His design, and avoid food addictions. Can you do that? The rest of the book, tell chapter after chapter why the foods God has created are healthy for you and what they give you. So that's what I would recommend. So here we have them selling the bran and germ to the cattle feed industry, very lucrative market, white flour to me and you. They said, no way, we're not going to put this back together because we don't want to give up that business. So I tell you what, we will fix this flour. I love the way people that don't care a thing about what's going on in your body, how they fix things, the solutions that the government and food industry and businesses come up with. What they chose to do was something that you and I know the word. And as a food scientist, when I saw that word on the bag of flour or a bag of bread, I thought, wow, aren't we just fortunate? They are just doing us such a wonderful favor. Isn't that what enrich means? To make something better? Let me see what you think. For the 35 to 40 nutrients that are lost when they sift the bran and germ away, they put four back in. Government mandated 1948 that they had to put three B vitamins and iron back in. Fix the problem, so they tell us, of beriberi, pellagra, and anemia. But let me ask you a question. How many nervous disorders do we have in this country today? How many GI disturbances do we have in this country today? How many skin eruptions do we have in this country today? And how much mental insanity do we have in this country today? And how many people are walking around anemic, just too tired to care? We've got a really, really, really serious problem here. And in 1998, 50 years, please notice this, 50 years, they watched the rising incidence of birth defects. So they said, okay, you better fix the flour again, and you better put some folic acid back in. So now today, they do add a fifth nutrient, folic acid, but only after 50 years of women suffering with their children birth defects. This is really, really a sad thing. All because we altered God's perfect provision, something Jesus compared himself to. You know, and don't think that this is just a modern thing, because from early on, bread was one of the first foods to be altered, not just in the 1900s, but people years ago, almost from the get-go, they figured out they could make these cloths out of papyrus, and they would sift the flour through that. And they knew that they could get the coarser bran and germ out of there, because you got to remember, back then, grinding between two stones, that flour was very coarse. And so they could get the coarser bran and germ out of there, and they knew that that white flour that they got, which is nothing like what we have today, white flour, but it did make whiter bread and fluffier bread. And but here's the deal. Prior to the 1900s, all these years, it was reserved for the wealthy, for the kings, the poor people, peasants, the us people, we would be considered peasants. We ate dirty bread. We ate bread that had the bran and germ in it, but not the kings, not the people that could afford to buy from the commercial bakeries. It was actually one of the first commercial industries was bakeries, where they would sift the flour. But the kings had this white bread. And have you ever thought about this scripture? I believe it's Proverbs 23. Be careful when you sit down to the king's table. Do not crave his dainties and his delicacies. You ever thought about that verse? It says they are deceitful food. Wow. A lot of people teach about that, you know, it's food offered to idols or, you know, whatever. But dainties and delicacies, I think that's white flour fluffy things. That's what I'm thinking. What did your grandmother tell you? Sift the flour, it makes a fluffier cake, right? Well, that's because my grandmother and her mother, my great-grandmother, probably had stone-ground flour, and they knew they had to sift it to get the coarser bran and germ out, and it would make a fluffier cake. You young people are probably looking at me like, I think she's crazy. I've never seen a recipe that told me to sift my flour. That's because the flour you're buying in the store has been pre-sifted. Have you ever read that on the bag? Pre-sifted. It's already white. You can't get any more out of white than white. But, and they started sifting it, and if that were not enough, they started bleaching it. Because of the residual vitamin A and vitamin E that was in the white flour, as it sat there forever and ever, it produced these yellow specks from oxidation. So, oh, we can't have yellow and brown specks in the flour from oxidation. People are going to think it's full. So they started bleaching it with a product called nitrogen trichloride. You hear the key word there, like you bleach your clothes with chlorine? Yeah, that's what you're eating. Yeah, you ever sat down and had a cup of chlorine bleach? No. You have probably if you've been eating bleached white bread. There's a British study done on a group of dogs where they fed them a diet of nitrogen trichloride bleached flour for 2 weeks. The article said they had the running fits so severe that some of them died. 2 weeks, we've been at this 100 years. 100 years. Grains are the perfect storable food. Jesus compared himself for a reason. Isaiah 55 verse 2 says this, why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your earnings for what does not satisfy? Heartbreaking to me, and one of the reasons I started a ministry, Real Bread Outreach, in 2007, which, by the way, it's a nonprofit, 501c3 ministry. We'll take donations. We're taking the bread to Haiti. But part of the reason my heart breaks, though I'm happy that the church wants to help people, do you see what our food banks and food closets have in them? Twinkies are a perfect storable food. They won't die if you try to kill it. I have a visual aid. I got to tell you this. I bought a very name brand, 100% whole grain bread from the store. Yeah. I bought it in August of 2014. What year is this?
2016.
Mm-hmm. I bought this in August 2014 as a visual aid in one of my classes to explain the difference in my freshly ground whole grain and commercially ground whole grain, which when the steel rolling mills came on the market and that white flour goes over there and they sift the bran and germ out, all flour is made that way now. And the only way you get whole grain is they recombine it according to a legal standard. Supposedly it has to have the same proportions, but I'm here today to tell you, it's not the same. They let them add extra protein and starch to it, which is basically more white flour, though in the food industry, it's not called flour, it's called gluten, which is not a bad thing, that's just the white flour portion. But it isolated out by itself, it's not considered flour. So they had to meet this proportion over here to be called whole grain, but now they let them dump all this gluten in there, third or fourth ingredient. Here's the deal. That I bought this loaf of bread to use as a visual aid, August of 2014. The sell-by date is September 2014. What year did y'all say we're in? March of 2016, the bread has not molded yet. 100% Pepperidge Farms, oh, are you recording? Scratch it up. Whole grain bread. It's not molded yet. I promise you, if you buy that loaf of bread of mine, it will be molded before 2018. Promise. It'll be molded by probably next week sometime. All right? Really, really, really significant problem. We have altered God's design and we're wondering why we're sick. God's perfect storable food. I want to, I actually have a handout here, Rich, if you want to give these out. Let's still talk just a few minutes. I know we want to be done, what, 8:15-ish? Is that right? 8:30 is what it said on my thing, but okay, so I want to talk a little bit about storing food. I told you our testimony, our Joseph vision, and how we invested in wheat. And I want to talk to you just a little bit about preparing. Anybody here just think that's kind of weird? I mean, y'all are here, you know Rich and his Joseph ministry. But how many of y'all just go, oh my gosh, is this prepper. Oh, dear.
I won't say it
from me. I will. I'll say that.
Okay. But, you know, bottom line is Joseph stored grain because God told him to store grain. He didn't store grain because someone else told him to store grain. He had a vision, he had a plan, and he came up with a plan. But the number one reason people don't store food is they just go, well, my neighbor is, I'll eat theirs, you know, or my church is, or what, or I don't want to be weird. But every one of you sitting here, you prepare. You prepare every single day of your life. I put on a coat tonight because it was colder outside. So I checked the weather. Oops, it's getting colder. This is what I wore to church this morning, but when I went to come here tonight, I'm like, I'm cold. I get my keys, I get my bottle of water, I check and see if it's going to be cold today, I check to see if it's going to rain, we take an umbrella, don't you? I mean, you're constantly planning and looking for the signs, right? You know, if it's going to rain, you're going to take a raincoat, particularly in the spring. It could be 80 degrees this morning, and just like today, it was a very nice day, this was fine. But then something happened, this cool front came in. So we're constantly checking and we're constantly planning. When you go on vacation, we take food everywhere we go. So I write out a menu and my grocery list. You're preparing. So why would we not prepare for a bigger, maybe, need or necessity? And what I love, one of the stories Dr. Williams talks about in his book is he was a medical doctor, and he said one of the things that they taught them in diagnosing was consider the obvious or the simplest thing first. And he said the way they explained it to them was if you hear hoofbeats behind you, gallops, ka-boom, 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 you know? I didn't do that very well. But anyway, what do you think that is coming up on you? What's the first thing you think of?
Horse.
It's a horse. Living in this country, you're not going to think it's a zebra. It could be a zebra, because zebras gallop like horses, but it's probably not a zebra. Kind of like when your car stops and you're driving down the road, you kind of ease over to the side. What's the first thing you think of? You check the gas gauge, right? You go, am I out of gas? You don't go, wow, I wonder if I need a complete overhaul in my engine. And you know, I mean, unless you heard some pretty weird, wild noises. But the first thing, right? Zebras, gas gauge. So many prepper mentality is I'm preparing for the zebra that could come instead of the horse that could come up behind me. Does that make any sense at all to you? Or that was just a cool analogy to me. What, a flood, an ice storm, a power outage, a gas leak. One neighborhood had to be completely evacuated because there was a gas leak in their neighborhood. Okay? And they had to be transported somewhere and, you know, a church if they had something. Do you see what I'm saying? Horses. Think horses at least. And if you prepare for the horse, guess what? You'll be prepared for the zebra. Okay? Or at least minimally. So that's just something that I want to throw in there. And the best time to start preparing, so I really, because I had planned to do my whole poopy talk tonight, and but I just think I really need to go on, and I don't know, I just feel weird talking poop and everything, but please get this CD, pop it in, listen to it on your way home, listen to it as you drive to work, because irritable bowel syndrome and constipation can go both be reversed almost immediately. Irritable bowel, 3 to 4 or 5 days. Because the fiber that's in grains can take care of that problem, chronic diarrhea, but it can take care of chronic constipation. Only God can make something like that. Your snotty noses, every nutrient to break down fat and cholesterol is in grains and beans. Every nutrient to boost your immune system. My family, my children, I have 9 children, they have only needed a doctor 3 times in the last 25 years. 3 times. You want the answer to the healthcare crisis? You want the answer to the rising cost of medical care? Don't need it. That's the best answer I can give you. We will go if we need to. And one of those was an ingrown toenail. The other was 2 of my children got whooping cough. And one was an ear infection because my daughter swam in an unheated pool in April every day till her lips turned blue for a week because we were on vacation and I didn't heat the pool. I thought Florida was hot. Not in April. You know, that's it. 3 times. 25 years. How many of you can say that? How many of you have children that are 23 and 20 that have never had an antihistamine a day in their life? That is huge. How many of you are I'm not going to make you say that. I was going to say, how many of you are constipated? No. I won't say that. But we've got to come back to God's way of eating and God's way of doing and celebrate His goodness. And I don't want to get weird. And I don't want y'all to think that I'm worshiping food or anything like that. I'm reading a book right now called Food and Faith. And I don't want to go way over here, but I'm telling you something. We need to get on our face and we need to repent. Because every prayer meeting at every church, probably 99%, I'd be willing to say at least 80 of the prayer requests, and I'm not saying don't pray, and I've been sick. I've had some serious things going. I've had cancer. But God healed me. But how many of our prayer requests, everybody's sick? That is the number one thing. And Haggai chapter 1 says this, consider your ways and how you have fared. You reap, you sow, but you reap little. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And this is the verse, this is the part of that that gets me the most. You earn wages to put them in a bag with holes in it. I cannot think of a bigger bag with bigger holes than we work and we work and we struggle to make ends meet, and we're buying this stuff that God did not create, that man has altered and reduced to a flavored, colored something out of a chemist pot that sends us to the doctor. So we're spending money here that's causing us to then put it in a bag and it's just going away. What did that mom say? I've spent more than that on one prescription drug that didn't work, and no one else in my family could enjoy it. At least the bread, your whole family can enjoy it, and you will enjoy it. And it's easy to do. I want to encourage you. I teach cooking classes. You can go on our website, pick up one of our cards out there. Go on our website. We have classes videoed and archived on our website. Saturday, I know it's Easter weekend, March 26th. I looked at my schedule. It's crazy between now and mid-June. So I had to pick dates that I could do it. And March 26th, Saturday morning, we're having a Getting Started class at our store. My next Getting Started class will be May 7th. The classes are $10. Come, I feed you the whole entire day, and I will walk you through the process. It is the easiest thing I have ever done. If you know there's a room in your house called a kitchen, and you know how to take out a bag of flour and make something with it, it is easy. You turn the mill on, you pour the grain in, and it comes out flour. People always look at me when I say I mill my own grain. They're like, you do what? Where do you live? What? I never could figure that one out. I think they thought I had a barn and I had to go around in circles or something like that. It's easy. If the kitchen is the room of your house that you just passed through and you're not sure that there's even an oven in there, you haven't seen it recently, then there might be a little bit of an adjustment to your lifestyle. But this is the easiest, most practical, most life-changing, most immediate health benefit thing you will ever do in your life. And it's coming back to God's way of being and doing. So I just can't encourage you enough to go there. I've already talked about Joseph, and I don't want you to feel overwhelmed or fearful when you store grain, but I do want you to know, did y'all ever realize this? When that famine was going on in Egypt, Genesis 43 verse 1 says that it was bad in the land. Jacob and his sons, of course, were in Israel, and Jacob sends his sons back, you know, back and forth. There's this back and forth, but he tells them, he says, take of the best fruits of the land in your vessels and carry them down to this man as a present. Did you hear what he just said?
Fruits.
They had fruit. They had food. They didn't have grain. And when Jesus said man does not live by bread alone, he was reiterating the fact that he was telling them basically, if you think just because you have bread that you can live forever, but you can't. And I am the real bread of life. He compared himself to things they knew. I am the real bread of life means I give life. I am the life. And he knew that they would make that connection. And he who comes to me shall be satisfied. Real bread is satisfying and it will not make you fat. So I thought that I would go over a few things that are practical for you to store. I gave you a handout there, and Brad, could you bring me those two things right there? This is just some suggestions. I kind of calculated out how much our family ate when we were first starting out with a family of seven children, eight, nine, counting Brad and I, so nine people. We ate about 45 pounds of grain a month, and I was making 12 loaves of bread a week, 12 loaves of bread a week, and then we would do other muffins and things like that. So I've given you a handout. I'm not going to labor over that too much. You can kind of look at that. And these are just